to Gold Point Family. I am on my way to Greenville to be able to run some errands. As I was coming, I thought about it. This week, we're going to talk about destination. Well, since we're talking about destination, why don't we go to one? Let's go ahead and go to a destination. Follow me. From dirt roads to highway, you're showing me a beautiful view from this backseat, where there's lots of room, and I never would have seen it if I wasn't rolling with you. There are some times that when we get to our when we're trying to get to our destination, we have some things to get in our way. Kind of like traffic lights. See, we're trying to get to our destination, but it's stopping us. But it won't stop us for long, because as soon as we're able to get the green light, we're going to start going. You got the wheel, take me where you want to go. My heart is yours, yours no matter where we roll. Been backseat my whole life, now I turn 16, so it's time to drive. Buckle up, true behind the wheel, got my iPhone bumping light. Locked and the map was set. Thought I had it all right till the road went left. Spinning out of control in this Coupe de Ville. Now I'm sitting shotgun. Jesus, take the wheel. You see, also traffic sometimes can stop us from getting to our through our journey to our destination. Would you take it over? Once again, sitting in traffic, trying to go through our journey to get to our destination. As we continue on, continue to follow us as we go. It's a little bit overdue, but I'm putting my trust in you. I'm putting my trust in you. We're almost to our destination. More traffic, more stoplights. Having to make U-turns. It's a whole new journey, a brand new path, and I'ma fix my eyes so I won't look back. Tame this beating heart in my chest, cause everything in me wants to jump ahead. So light it up, don't let it fade. Light it up, show me the way. Light it up, Lord, just like you do. No second guessing, I'ma move with you. So guys, thank y'all for going with me to the destination. You see, on a journey, as you go through life, there's a lot of red lights. Maybe it's the idea of having U-turns, or maybe it's just a lot of traffic. There are some times in life when that journey is hard, it's tough, but in the end, the destination is so, so good.
Look, I ain't gonna lie either. I didn't just have one. Oh my goodness, I had good night. My goodness. Well, good morning. Welcome to Gold Point Church of Christ. I am glad to come and be able to speak to you this morning. Mr. Chris and his family are gone and out of town, so I'm so glad to be able to come and preach to y'all this morning. As we do, like I said, we're gonna talk about the idea of destiny. And before we get started, I got to tell you a little story. There was one time when Mr. Chris and I were on the boat, and he were on his boat, and we're in the border of North Carolina and Virginia. And we hit a lot of no-wake zones where you can't use your engine. You just got to coast through. Well, we hit four or five of them things. And as we hit them, next thing you know, he says, look, the next one, put the trolling motor down, and we're going to go ahead and start fishing. And so, hey, he's to his word. We hit another no-wake zone. He put down the trolling motor, and he started fishing. Now, this is my secret. I watch to see what he's about to pick up, so then I can try to decide out of my two little rods of what I'm going to pick, you know, because of what he's got. And so I see what he picked up. I'm like, I ain't got that, but I'm going to try this. And so I took it, and we started, you know, casting a little bit and stuff like that. For some reason, I don't know what the reasoning was, but he looked behind him, and he looked up, and he said, we got to go. Like, we got to go. And I was like, what you mean? And so I just cast it again and started reeling back a little bit. He's like, no, we got to go. So he pulled. By the time I get done throwing out again, he pulls up the trolling motor, puts his rods down, ties them down, sits in the seat, starts the engine, and he's about to go. And I'm like, oh, we got to go. And so all of a sudden, I'm reeling in as fast as I can, and boy, that thing takes forever. And so I take, and I finally put my rod down. And by the time I sit down, my bottom is not even touching the seat, and we are gone. I was like, what in the world? Like, what's wrong? And he looked up, and he pointed. And it's a thunderstorm cloud that is coming right to us, but not only right to us, but coming around us as well. Luckily, as we were going, there was an overpass, and luckily we were able to stay under there just for a little bit, about 20, 30 minutes. And he looked up and he's like, this thing ain't going nowhere. So for 20, 30 minutes, he had the trolling motor down and we were fishing underneath the overpass. And so we didn't catch anything, but we were sitting there underneath the overpass and it still was raining like crazy. Mr. Chris said this. He said, we can do one of two things. He said, we can stay here, which is all right. He said, or we can get to a better place. And I thought about it and I was like, well, I don't know as much as you know. You know, whatever you think is best, we'll do. So he puts his rod down, he gets and sits down, and he starts his motor. I knew this time I was already done, put my rod down and already sitting down before he started the motor. And so we start going. And as he was going, we were getting hit with this rain and pellets and all these things. So I had a thin little hat on. It was real thin. And I had my hands over my head because it was hurting at the top there. Oh, my goodness. And so I had my hands over my head like this as we were going. He's over there and he had a sweatsuit on, but that didn't help the rain pellets. They were still hitting him just as hard. And as we were driving, I was thinking about what he said. We can stay in this, which is all right, or we can get to a better place. And I thought about that as he was driving the boat, and I was like, that's such a good thought. Like in our spiritual life or in life in general, there are some times when we may be in a tough spot or be in a spot where we can always be in a better spot. And so I thought about that, and I was like, so I use that to kind of start the message with the idea that, you know, there's sometimes when we're in a tough spot, there's always a better spot to go. If you don't mind, let's pray, and then we'll get started. Dylan, Father, Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your grace. We thank you for this time that we're going to be able to open up your word and hopefully learn more about your word and learn more about and understand more about what's being talked about. We thank you for your goodness and your grace, and we thank you for dying on the cross for us and raising from the grave for us to have life and for us to have life through you. We thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. As we get started this morning, if you don't mind turning your Bibles to Philippians chapter 1, and we're going to look in verse 12. Philippians chapter 1, verse 12. As you're turning there, we're going to read this first little part, and it's going to explain kind of what Paul's situation is. As he's writing to the church of Philippi, as he's writing to this church, he is in jail. He's in prison at this time. And so it's going to really help us to understand what's being said as Paul's writing to them this morning. And what he said to them back then. And so Philippians 1, 12 through 26 is what we're going to look at tonight. It's going to go quick, I promise. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have confidence in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. You see, there's a couple of things that I thought of when Paul was writing this to this church. Is number one, he's not looking at the distractions that are going on in his life. He's not looking at the idea of where he's in prison, but he's writing to this church to be able to help them. His distraction isn't the fact that he's in prison or that more than likely he got beaten with punishment of preaching the way he is or preaching for Christ. Or maybe it's even the idea of how do I get out of here, out of prison, to be able to continue on spreading the gospel. He sees his focus. And the biggest focus is that staying focused on the mission that he was called to do. You see, I think about us in our lives today. There's a lot of distractions that are going on, and distractions in the way that it's important for us to understand and to know of what's going on. But we don't need to lose focus of the things that are most important, and that's in Jesus Christ continuing to spread his word. distractions that we may have is maybe the coronavirus and all this stuff going on. Maybe it's the idea of voting and this is the year that we vote for the particular party that we decide to vote for. Maybe it's the idea of your job, but not only your job, but also maybe you've possibly lost your job through the coronavirus. Or maybe it's the idea that maybe you haven't lost your job, but you got your job, and then when you come home, you got to cook dinner, and you also got to help your kids go through school and do schooling online and all these different things. Maybe it's the idea that, you know, maybe you haven't had as much time being able to be with family with quality time because you got all these other things that we have going on. There are so many things that can distract us from the true focus that we need to have, and that's in Jesus Christ. Staying focused on the mission that we are called to do and to be. Check this out. Focus. So this is what Paul did. Paul focused on the outcome, not the obstacles. He didn't look at his obstacles and say, man, we're just going to have to stop right here. No, he said, I am going through obstacles, but through these obstacles, I am going to have an outcome of being able to continue to spread God's word. And as he said that, he said, In the end of that passage, it says, and because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. Paul's in prison, but yet the gospel is still being preached. Check this out. In verse 15, it says, it is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. You see, Paul's in prison right now, and it says right here, it says that they are stirring up trouble for him. So not only is he in jail right now, but they're basically like kicking him while he's in jail. Not only are they preaching for that, but they're preaching for envy and rivalry. They're preaching to be able to gain their motives for gaining their wisdom and all these things, and not for Christ and the good motives of love and to help the gospel be spread. Let me explain in this way. This is a picture that my parents and I went to. We went to Reno for a bowling tournament one year. And so my parents' house is all the way on the right side. And we're trying to get to Reno, basically on the other side of the United States. And as we were, the blue line that's going across right there is actually the line that we took the first time. We took this line to be able to get to Reno. Not too bad. Pretty much a straight shot. A little bit of a upper climb there and back down. Not a big deal at all. Well, then, on our way back, do you see that gray line that comes down right there? That's the way that the GPS decided to take us on our way back from Reno. It took us up into nearly Chicago. Never forget, Dad says, these signs are saying, go to Chicago, go this way. And he's like, what in the world? And so we went all the way up to Chicago and came back down. Look, there was about 6 different tolls that we hit on our way back. About 6 different tolls. And not only that, but they actually, the GPS brought us into Washington, D.C. at rush hour traffic. So I'm going to be honest with you. We barely made it back in time to be able to take the rental car back to the place that we originally got it from. If we would have went the other way, it would have been so much quicker. Even though it looks like that the GPS is saying, oh, well, if there's no traffic, no tolls, no this, no that, this way should be quicker. Well, that's the way we took. But if we looked at the big picture, if we saw the big picture of what the GPS was showing us, we wouldn't have went that way. Paul here is seeing that even if people want to preach out of envy and rivalry, even if they want to preach out of selfish ambition, or even if they want to stir up trouble for me while I'm in prison in chains, he says, what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Paul rejoices, even if he's in trouble, even if he's in prison, even if they're stirring up trouble. He continues to rejoice because of what happened. So if we saw the big picture, we would have went a different way. Paul, I bet you, wish that he wasn't in the situation that he's in right now. In prison, right to this church. He probably wishes that he was not in this position. But he sees the big picture. The big picture of seeing where Christ is being preached. It says, yes, I will continue to rejoice, for I know through your prayers and God's vision from the Spirit of Jesus Christ. What has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have significant courage, so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in the body, whether by life or by death. Oh, this is one of my favorite little passages, a little verse. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What Paul is saying here is so important for us to understand. That regardless if he's going to continue to live, going to pass away, Christ is going to be preached as long as he's here on earth. We see that Paul's in prison right now, but not only that, in 2 Corinthians, we're going to see where he has been through a lot of different things in life. Check this out. In 2 Corinthians 11, 21 through 28, it says, I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the ashes minus one. 3 times I've been beaten with rods. 1 I was pelted with stones. 3 I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open seas. I've been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers and danger from bandits, and danger from fellow Jews, and danger from Gentiles, and dangers of cities, and dangers of countries, and dangers of sea, and dangers of false believers. And toiled. I have gone often without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst. I have gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face daily pressures of my concern for all the churches. Paul has been through a lot of things in his life. And as he does, he continues to spread the gospel and continue to see Christ being preached. If I had to describe it in this way, Paul saw the destination of heaven, the destination is greater than the suffering of the journey that he had to go. Paul saw the destination of heaven so much greater than the suffering of the journey that he had to face. Going through all these different things that we just read about, he says, that's okay. Because when I get to my destination, when I get to where I want to be, and that's with Christ, he says, it's going to be all right. It's going to be all good. It's going to be better. It's kind of this way. Let me think about it this way as well. When you go on a road trip, you think about what you need to carry and what you need to you need to, as you get ready to go on vacation or going on a trip, wherever you're going, and maybe you're going to the racetracks or a football game or something like that. Well, you need to make sure you get your tickets in advance, right? You need to make sure you get the hotel room in advance. You got to make sure that you have plenty of clothes and what you're going to wear. And maybe if you have kids, you're going to have to, you know, pack for them as well. And all these different things. Maybe you need to help your husband a little bit pack too. You pack all this stuff up and then you're on the road. And as you're on the road, if you got kids, I'm hungry, I need to use the restroom. Are we there yet? I mean, all these different things and all these different things are being said and things you have to do. But as you get ready to go on this journey, you're hoping that that destination that you're going to is worth the journey of getting there. I mean, if you go somewhere, you want the destination to be greater than the journey of getting there. And that's exactly what Paul's saying here. Paul saw the destination of getting to the finish line, to live as Christ and to die as gain, is greater than the suffering of the journey that he was going to have to face. And I think about our lives as well. Do we feel that way as well? Do we see that destination that we're trying to get to is heaven? Do we see that as important as the different things that we have to go on, the suffering that we have to face? Do we see it as important to be able to go through these things so we can understand what we receive when we get to that destination? And in verse 22, it says, I am going to go on living in the body. This will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet, what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart to be with Christ, and who wouldn't? And it says, which by far, but it is more necessary for me to remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue with you, with all of you, for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Jesus Christ will abound on account of me. If we have that same mindset that Paul had, if we had that mindset that destination is so much greater, even if you got to go through a journey of trials and tribulations, if we see our mindset as Paul and we keep the journey, then we and so many others who we tell people about Christ and that good news and that destination that we're going to, so many others will be able to get to the destination with us together. As we get ready to close this morning, some of y'all may be at that point where maybe your journey has been rough. Maybe your journey has been extremely hard. And maybe you're at that point when you're like, look, Jesus, I was thinking about playing this song during that video. Jesus, take the wheel. Jesus, take it. I'm so tired of it. Maybe you're at that point where you're like, I just need prayer. I just need to know that you got this under control. Maybe you're at that point where you're like, man, you're on that border of do I want to get baptized into Christ? Do I want to be a Christian? All these things. Maybe you're at that point where you're kind of questioning about your faith and how to grow deeper in your faith. Whatever it may be, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing our invitation song. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you give to us. We thank you for this time that we're able to and just see the things that Paul was going through. But Father, we see especially the destination is so greater than the journey that we're trying, that we're going through to try to get to that destination. Father, it's because of you and because of Jesus Christ of why we are able to get to that destination and why we're able to understand the goodness of what you have done for us as you died on the cross and you rose from the grave. Father, as we get ready to close this morning, I pray that we can go out into the world and tell people about the destination that we're trying to get to. We thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.